Yeah, good evening, all. Myself, Dr. Kiran Verma, working as consultant and head of the emergency department at Yashoda Hospital, Malakpet. So here I would like to take this an opportunity to welcome you all on behalf of Yashoda Group of Hospitals for this series of webinars conducted by emergency and critical care departments on every alternate Tuesdays. So today we have come up with an interesting topic, IIT dissection. The reason behind for choosing this topic is very simple. So it is too tricky to diagnose in the emergency department. If you don't diagnose this patient emergency department, see, it leads to death. It is high fatal disease. If you diagnose the disease in the emergency department, you can predict the outcome. Sometimes you can even dictate the outcome as well. So why we are talking this is tricky disease to diagnose emergency department? Because it has got wide spectrum of symptoms, like few patients present with chest pain. Then some other patient present with paraplegia. Some other patient present with even breathing difficulty due to pericardial effusions. So it has got wide spectrum of symptoms. So it is very tricky to diagnose in the emergency department. That's why we have selected this topic for this webinar. So with this brief introduction, I would like to welcome you two speakers. First one, Dr. Nisha Mohan, who is emergency resident final year. Then second one, Dr. Prakash Thora, sir, who is chief vascular surgeon at Yashoda Hospital, Malakpet. So to moderate this session, we have one more moderate who will be joining soon with us, Dr. M.N. Suresh, head of the department, emergency at Somajiguda. So with this brief introduction, I would like to hand over the mic to Dr. Nisha.
Thank you, sir. Hi, good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Nisha, DNB resident in the emergency department, Yashoda, Malakpet. So I'll be starting the case discussion with a case which came to our ER in the last week. A 53-year-old male patient who came with a history of sudden onset of severe epigastric pain of 1 hour duration. There was no comorbidities, and on arrival to ER, the patient's airway was patent.
Nisha, we're unable to see your slides.
And please share the screen.
Share the screen.
One second. On in this slide.
Doctor, ma'am, we are unable to see your slides.
One second, sir.
Yeah, Nisha, it's okay now. Sorry for the technical glitches. Nisha, hello. Are you here?
Yeah, sir.
Yeah, you can continue.
Okay, so I'll be starting the discussion with a case which came to our ER in the last week. So there was a 53-year-old male patient who came with a history of sudden onset of severe epigastric pain of 1 hour duration. So he had no comorbidities. On arrival to ER, the patient's airway was patent. He was tachypneic with a room air saturation of 84%. So we immediately started him on oxygen support with face mask at 5 liter. His heart rate was 41 and peripheral pulses were not palpable. His right arm BP was 70 systolic and left arm BP was 50 systolic. So we immediately started on IV fluids. Clinical examination didn't reveal much clues. There were no murmur, no adventitious sounds. Only the patient was tachypneic. Parabdominal examination, it was soft, non-tender, and bowel sounds were present. There were no focal neurological deficits. So from the physical examination and history, we came to a conclusion of differential diagnosis of acute coronary syndrome, pulmonary embolism, aortic dissection. So next we got a total ECG done immediately, which showed non-specific STT changes. There were no ST elevations or depression. So we got a 2D echo done. So this was the 2D echo, which showed a dilatation of the aortic tube. So we narrowed down the differential diagnosis to aortic dissection and immediately got a CT aortogram done. So this was the CT aortogram. Sorry, it is coming ultra. Because the CT aortogram revealed a type A dissection extending all the way down to descending aorta. So unfortunately, right after the CT, the patient suffered a cardiac arrest in the CT module, and despite our best efforts, we were not able to revive the patient. So aortic dissection. So aortic dissection is a longitudinal cleavage of the aortic media created by the dissecting column of blood. It's 3 times more common in men, and in women, it's usually presents as poor prognosis. So these were data collected from the International Registry of Acute Dissection, which show the demographic and clinical features. So it usually it's more common in males of more than 62 years of age, and type A dissections were more common, and patients usually had a history of hypertension. Risk factors includes hypertension. Genetically triggered diseases such as Marfan syndrome, bicuspid aortic valve, Lois Bleed syndrome, vascular Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, and congenital diseases such as coarctation of aorta, Turner syndrome, and tetralogy of Fallot. Then atherosclerosis. So atherosclerosis can cause penetrating atherosclerotic ulcers, which can cause aortic dissection. Then trauma or iatrogenic. Iatrogenic, like in intra-aortic balloon pump insertion or any aortic manipulation. Then cocaine use, pregnancy, and inflammatory conditions. So these are the risk factors. Next, coming to the pathophysiology. So aorta consists of 3 layers, the intima, media, and adventitia. Intima is the innermost layer and adventitia is the outermost layer. The precursor for aortic dissection is the degeneration of the media with loss of smooth muscle cells, elastic tissue, followed by scarring, fibrosis, and hyaline-like changes. There will be also inflammatory cell infiltration into the media. So the repetitive dynamic force, hemodynamic forces, which is produced by the blood flow into the aorta, will lead to the weakening of the aortic intima and will cause medial degeneration. So in patients with hypertension, the sustained hypertension will just intensify this process. So all this will result in tear of the aortic intima, and a column of blood will enter the media. There is another alternative theory which suggests that aortic dissection can occur due to the rupture of vasa vasorum. So vasa vasorum are the vessels which supplies the aortic wall. So the repetitive force will damage the vasa vasorum of aorta, and it will cause rupture of the vasa vasorum, and this will cause hemorrhage into the aortic media. So once the hematoma forms, the hematoma can migrate in antigrade or retrograde fashion, and it will form a false lumen in the outer half. Coming to classification. There are 2 types of classification, that is DeBakey classification and Stanford classification. So DeBakey is the oldest classification, which were described in 1965. So according to DeBakey, the aortic dissection is classified into 3 types. Type 1, in which the dissection originates in the ascending aorta, and it can propagate at least to the aortic arch, and it can often propagate beyond. In type 2, the aortic dissection originates in the ascending aorta, and it is confined to the ascending aorta. In type 3, the dissection originates in the descending aorta, and it can extend distally. Rarely, it can also extend retrograde fashion. Another classification is Stanford classification, which was described in 1970, and this is the most widely used classification nowadays. So according to Stanford classification, aortic dissection is divided into 2 groups, that is type A and type B dissection. Type A dissections are dissection which originates proximal to the left subclavian artery, and type B dissections are which originates distal to the left subclavian artery. So type B dissection does not involve the ascending aorta. Coming to clinical features. So pain is the most common clinical symptom complained by the patient. So this pain can be abrupt onset, severe, and usually they describe as a sharp pain. It is excruciating pain. So the location of the pain can help in identifying the location of inguinal tear. If the patient is complaining of the anterior chest pain, it's usually the location of inguinal tear will be ascending aorta. And if the patient is complaining of neck or jaw pain, usually the site of inguinal tear will be aortic arch. In case of inguinal tear in the descending thoracic aorta above the level of diaphragm, the patient will usually complain pain in the interscapular area. And when there is an inguinal tear in the descending thoracic aorta below the level of diaphragm, patient can complain pain in the abdominal or lumbar area. They can also present with visceral symptoms such as diaphoresis, nausea, vomiting, and lightheadedness. And some patients can present with a syncope. So syncope is usually due to dissection into the pericardium, hypovolemia, excess vagal tone, or cardiac conduction abnormalities. In some patients, when there is a proximal tear, patient can present with a cardiac tamponade also. In 3% of the cases, the dissection can extend into the ostium of the coronary artery. So usually right coronary artery will be involved. So these patients will present with a myocardial infarction, usually inferior wall myocardial infarction. Then some patients can present with neurological symptoms, that is focal weakness and altered mental status. These commonly occur in type A dissection. And when there is a dissection in or near the carotid artery, patient can present with the symptoms of classic stroke. When there is a distal dissection which occludes the anterior spinal artery, that can disrupt the blood supply to the spinal cord, and patients can present with ischemic paraparesis or ischemic peripheral neuropathy. And if the dissection extends distally into the abdomen, patients can present with mesenteric ischemia, renal failure, femoral pulse deficit, and extremity ischemia. There is a deadly triad, that is chest pain, hypotension, and branch vessel involvement. The patients presenting with the deadly triad, it is an independent predictor of in-hospital death. So mortality will be very high in these patients. Coming to clinical examination. So pulse deficit can be present in 15% of the cases. And patients can present with interarm BP difference of more than 20 mmHg. In about 20% cases, there will be an aortic insufficiency murmur. When there is a type A dissection, patient can present with hypotension. It can also be due to hypovolemic cardiac tamponade. Majority of the patients will be presenting with hypertension. So it is more common in type B dissection than type A dissection. Then there is another entity called pseudohypotension. So when the patient present with hypotension, you should first rule out this pseudo-hypotension. So in pseudo-hypotension is a condition where the BP and the arms will be low or not recordable, whereas the central arterial BP will be normal or high. This is due to the interruption of blood supply into the subclavian artery. So coming to aortic dissection, coming to evaluation. So this is the aortic dissection detection risk score. So in acute aortic dissection, these are the data from the data collected from the International Registry of Acute Aortic Dissection. The clinical features, that is the high-risk features which were associated with the acute aortic dissection, were classified into three groups. So three categories were defined. The category one, patients with underlying conditions such as Marfan syndrome or any family history of aortic disease, aortic valvular diseases, then recent aortic manipulation, and thoracic aortic aneurysm. Category 2 included patients with pain in chest, back, or abdomen, which is of severe in intensity, abrupt onset, and ripping or tearing type. Category 3 included patients with abnormal examination findings, such as pulse amplitude difference, interarm BP difference, then focal neurological deficits, new murmur of aortic insufficiency, and shock or hypotension. Each category were given a point of 1, and the score ranged from 0 to 3. So there have been several studies going on in the use of aortic dissection detection risk score in low-risk patients to rule out acute aortic syndrome. So they have found out that aortic dissection detection risk score of 0 to 1 is associated with a low risk for acute aortic syndrome, and we can rule out acute aortic syndromes. So ECG, usually there will be non-specific. It will be non-specific in 41 to 62% of the cases. And there can be new QFs or ST elevation in 3 to 4%. ST depression can be present in 15 to 20% cases, and in 30% cases, the ECG will be normal. So these are some case report which were reported from 2009 to 2013, in which the patients were with acute aortic dissection presented as acute pericarditis. So ECG suggested features of acute pericarditis, but when they did serial ECGs and further evaluation, turned out to be aortic dissection. Then biomarker. There are several biomarkers under study for aortic dissection, but the most thoroughly investigated biomarker is D-dimer. So D-dimer cutoff point is 500 nanogram per ml, but it is not used as a sole means for ruling out aortic dissection. So there was one trial which was particularly done, which integrated the acute aortic dissection detection risk score and D-dimer levels for ruling out aortic dissection. That was ADVICE trial. So the ADVICE trial was this was a multi-center prospective observational study involving 6 hospitals in 4 countries, which was conducted from 2014 to 2016. So they integrated a aortic dissection detection risk score of 0 to 1 with a D-dimer value of less than 500. So they found out that when you integrate aortic dissection detection risk score with a negative D-dimer value, it is effective in diagnostic rule out of acute aortic syndrome. This is another meta-analysis for the usage of D-dimer as a rule-out criteria for aortic dissection. So they in this meta-analysis, it suggested that a negative D-dimer result may be useful to help to rule out the acute aortic dissection in low-risk patients. This is another systematic review of aortic dissection detection risk score plus D-dimer for diagnostic rule-out of suspected acute aortic syndrome. This was published in March 2020, which gave similar results. This is another novel biomarker which is currently under study, that is soluble ST2. So the soluble ST2 or suppression tumorigenicity 2 is currently used as a prognostic marker for heart failure. It is an interleukin 1 receptor family member, but there are several studies being done and for the use of this soluble ST2 as a rollout criteria for aortic dissection. So this particular study was published in 2017, which was a prospective cohort study including 1027 patients. So they found out that soluble ST2 showed superior diagnostic performance, but still we don't know if it can be used as a rollout criteria for aortic dissection. So currently the only biomarker which is being used for ruling out aortic dissection is D-dimer. So further studies are required in this field. Coming to imaging. So chest X-ray can provide clues regarding the presence of aortic dissection. So in chest X-ray, the common findings include a widened mediastinum, abnormal aortic condo, pleural effusion, deviation of trachea, deviation of mainstem bronchial. Another modality of imaging is transesophageal echocardiography, which can be done bedside, but it is highly operator dependent and specialized expertise in the field is required, and patient needs to be sedated or intubated for performing this, but can identify the intimal flap or the location of dissection. Coming to CT scan. So CT scan is currently the imaging modality of choice. So CT scan with and without contrast is done, and it can reliably identify the false lumen. It can also provide additional details like anatomy of the dissection, location of dissection flaps, and extension of the dissection. So the choice of investigation depends upon the facilities available in the receiving hospital and the clinician discretion. So these were the data collected from International Registry of Aortic Dissection, which showed the sensitivity and specificity of different imaging modalities. So according to them, the MRI with gadolinium can have 100% sensitivity and specificity, and CT scan with contrast also has high specificity and sensitivity. Transesophageal echocardiography is as specific and sensitive as CT scan, but as I said earlier, there is expertise is needed in this field, and patient needs to be sedated or intubated. So these are the advantages and disadvantages of various imaging modalities. So MRI has high sensitivity and specificity, and gadolinium contrast has better safety profile, but it is not usually not readily available, and if the patient is unstable, it is difficult to do MRI, and it is time consuming. Whereas CT is easily available, less time consuming, it is quicker than MRI, and but there is risk of radiation exposure and iodinated contrast. Transesophageal echocardiography is equally effective, but it is semi-invasive and requires anesthesia or intubation. It can induce hypertension and it can also cause esophageal trauma. Coming to the management part, so in ED, the goal is to decrease the continued shear stress on dissection plaque and prevent the further damage. So this is achieved by reducing the BP to a systolic of 100 to 120 and reducing the heart rate to less than or equal to 60 per minute. In aorta dissection, majority of the patient presents as hypertensive emergency. So our first goal is to reduce the heart rate to less than or equal to 60 and reduce the BP to 100 to 120. So beta blockers are the cornerstone of management. We can use several beta blockers like labetalol, atenolol, metoprolol, esmolol, etc. So labetalol is a combined alpha-1 selective and non-selective beta-blocking activity with an alpha to beta-blocking activity of 1:7 ratio. It is given as an initial bolus dose of 20 mg IV given every 5 to 10 minutes to a total dose of 300 mg, followed by an infusion of 1 to 2 mg per minute. Onset is within 2 to 5 minutes and peaks by 15 minutes. Duration is for 2 to 4 hours. It is safe in pregnancy and it maintains the renal, cerebral and coronary blood flow. Esmolol is another ultra-short acting beta blocker which is cardioselective. Onset is within 60 seconds usually and duration is 10 to 20 minutes. It is given as an initial dose of IV bolus dose of 250 to 500 microgram per kg and an infusion of 50 to 200 mics per kg per minute. It should be used with caution in asthma and COPD. And it is ideal for patients with mild to moderate LV dysfunction, but it should be avoided in patients with decompensated cardiac failure. And the extravasation of the drug can cause skin necrosis and sloughing. This was one particular study which was published recently in 2020. So they compared the high dose intravenous labetalol versus esmolol combination therapy in patients with aortic dissection. This was a single center retrospective study. So they concluded that labetalol is associated with higher incidence of hemodynamic instability. But till now they have not proved that any drug is superior to the other. So we can use esmolol or labetalol. These are alternative agents such as vasodilators for decreasing the BP. So first is nitroprusside. Nitroprusside is a potent arterial and venodilator and it is started as a continuous infusion of 0.3 to 0.5 mics per kg per minute. It is titrated by 0.5 mics per kg per minute and it will decrease the preload and afterload. Its onset is within seconds and the duration is 1 to 2 minutes. But the problem with nitroprusside is a concomitant beta blocker is needed when we start nitroprusside. And a dose of more than 2 mg per kg per minute can cause cyanide toxicity. So this should be kept in mind while starting nitroprusside infusion. Next drug is nicardipine. So nicardipine is a second line agent and it is also started as a continuous infusion of 5 mg per hour, which is increased by 2.5 mg per hour every 5 to 15 minutes. So this is a dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker, which is cardioselective and which has very little effect on heart rate. So there were several studies going on for the use of nicardipine, but as of now, it is considered only as a second line agent. It is not considered as a first line agent yet. So it is an excellent alternative for beta blockers in patients who cannot tolerate beta blockers. So the maximum dosage of nicardipine is 50 mg per hour. The onset of action will be 5 to 15 minutes and duration is 1 to 4 hours. It decreases the peripheral vascular resistance and it is avoided in advanced aortic stenosis. Next is phenyldopam. Phenyldopam is a dopamine 1 receptor agonist, which is also started as a continuous infusion of 0.1 to 0.3 mics per kg per minute and is titrated by 0.05 to 0.1 mics per kg per minute every 15 minutes to a desired BP. Then maximum dosage is 1.6 mics per kg per minute and the onset of action will be within 5 minutes, it peaks within 15 minutes and the duration is usually 30 to 60 minutes. This is metabolized by liver without P450 system. But the problem with phenyldopam is it will cause reflex tachycardia. It should be started only after beta blockers. So in patients with COPD in whom we cannot give labetalol or esmolol, we can start alternative cardioselective agent like metoprolol or atenolol. So this is the algorithm for blood pressure control in ED. So first, when the patient comes with a hypertensive emergency, the first goal is to control heart rate and pain. So pain control is achieved by intravenous opiates like fentanyl, and rate control can be achieved by beta blockers. Then next step is pressure control. So if the pressure control is not achieved by beta blockers, then we can consider alternative drugs such as vasodilators, that is nitroprusside or nicardipine. The goal BP is less than 120 or the lowest possible BP, which that maintains adequate organ perfusion. Then if the patient presents with hypotension, it is usually managed with IV fluids. You should measure BP in all four limbs and always rule out pseudo-hypotension. Then surgical management. So definitive therapy is always surgical management, and the immediate indication of surgery include type A dissection, branch occlusion, leak, and continued extension despite optimal medical management. So type A dissections are always a surgical emergency and require prompt surgical treatment. So in hospital mortality rate in patients with type A dissection when treated with surgery is 27% and when treated with medical therapy it is 56%. So this is one kind of surgery which is used for type A dissection, that is elephant trunk stent fenestration. Then type B dissection. Type B dissections are usually divided into two groups, that is complicated and uncomplicated type B dissection. So complicated type B dissections are the dissections associated with end organ ischemia, leaking ruptures, aortic dilatation, or intractable pain. So usually there are two types of surgery, that is open surgical management and endovascular management. Endovascular management, the goals are coverage of proximal entry tail, expansion of true lumen with the restoration of blood flow to the vessels, and obliteration of the false lumen. So the obliteration of the false lumen flow with thrombus is required because the patency of a false lumen will result in aneurysmal degeneration of the aorta. So these endovascular surgeries are tried nowadays. So there are two trials which describe the importance of endovascular repair in uncomplicated type B aortic dissection, that is ATSOT trial, and one is INSTEAD trial. So in both these trials, they have taken patients with uncomplicated type B dissection and they compared best medical treatment with the best medical treatment plus endovascular surgery. So they found out that thoracic endovascular repair with the best medical treatment is always better for the patient and it decreases mortality. So this is another trial, that is Table 2 clinical trial on endovascular treatment of complicated type B aortic dissection. So this was a prospective multicenter study which was conducted in 73 patients. And they found out that at 30 days, the mortality was 6.8%. And at 1 year, there was 100% partial or complete false lumen thrombosis in stent grafted region and 97% in the bare stent region. Short note on malperfusion syndrome. So malperfusion syndromes are end organ ischemia secondary to the aortic branch compromise. It can occur in one or more vascular beds. So the occurrence of malperfusion syndrome depends upon the percentage of aortic circumference dissected, the presence of a distal reentrant focus in the false versus true lumen outflow, and topography of the branch ostia to true versus false lumen. The mechanism of malperfusion syndrome include dynamic obstruction and static obstruction. So dynamic obstruction is more common, that is seen in 80% of the cases. Dynamic obstruction occurs when the true lumen is unable to provide adequate volume flow or the dissection flap is prolapsing into the vessel ostia. Static obstruction occurs when the dissection process extends into the branch vessel proper and narrow it, or the false lumen will thrombus and cause hypoperfusion of the vessel. So static obstruction always require intervention. In malperfusion treatment, it is usually treated with endovascular treatment or percutaneous fenestration or open surgical treatment. So open surgical treatment is usually done in dynamic obstruction. So this is the algorithm for evaluation of a suspected aortic dissection patient. So whenever a patient comes to ER and in whom we have a high suspicion for aortic dissection, first look for high risk features. The high risk features include the high risk conditions like Marfan syndrome or any connective tissue disorders or any non-aortic diseases. Then high-risk pain characteristics such as abrupt and severe onset pain with a gesturing or sharp in quality. And high-risk physical examination findings like pulse deficit, difference in BP between two arms, focal neurological deficits, or murmur of aortic regurgitation, hypotension, or shock. If there is two or more high-risk features present, then the patient is considered as a high-risk group, and immediate surgical consultation should be sought, and immediate aortic imaging should be done. Aortic imaging is clinician discretion. You can either go for a transesophageal echocardiography or MRI or CT scanning. So if one modality is inconclusive, we can always go for a second modality. Then if the patient is having only a single high-risk feature, then he is considered as an intermediate risk patient. So then we have to rule out ACS syndrome from ECG. So after ruling out ACS, we can go for chest X-ray to rule out other causes of chest pain. And then if still it is highly suggestive of aortic dissection, then go for immediate aortic imaging. If the patient is low risk group, that is there is no high risk features, first rule out all other conditions. And if still there is a high suspicion for aortic dissection, you can go for an aortic imaging. So take home message: aortic dissection is an uncommon but potentially deadly condition, and complications can develop rapidly. So early detection and timely intervention is necessary. So most common presentation is usually pain, and the chronic hypertension is a predominant risk factor. Ultrasound is an important bedside adjunct, and we can easily identify aortic dissection in a bedside ultrasound. So management in ED should be always focused on reduction of BP and heart rate and pain control. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nisha. It's really an excellent presentation. Okay, I've seen all the things like recent trials, what are drugs to be given. Really, it is an excellent topic. Excellent. You presented very well. So now we'll move on to the next session. Dr. Prakash sir, I welcome you. So Dr. Prakash sir, our senior and eminent vascular surgeon working for Yashoda Hospital, Malakpet. So he will give his expertise, and so he will insight on aortic dissection. I hand over mic to Dr. Prakash sir.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. Dr. Nisha, it was a very good presentation. I really enjoyed going through your slides, and it was a really nice presentation. There is nothing more to add to whatever you have said, but few of the things which I would like to add is the practical points which I want to tell, because I have also prepared a PowerPoint, but I don't think there is a point in showing the same things again and again. Few things which I have noted down while you were presenting is which we need to focus as clinicians, more so as emergency physicians, because you are the first line of defense. You see the patient for the first time. By the time a consultant comes or people like me who come, there is already diagnosis that is made. So you are the people who will be taking care. You are the first line of defense. You have to see the patient. You see for the first time, and then you make a call depending on what the patient is suffering from. So there are two things which we have to consider. Whenever a patient coming with acute chest pain, acute back pain, what is called as acute chest syndromes, these things we have to consider. The first thing is acute chest syndrome. The most common is still was, and I think it will still be an acute coronary syndrome. There is no debate on that. So first you rule out, you go meticulously, patient presenting, any age patient presenting with an acute chest, you cannot say that because we have read about aortic dissection today, tomorrow a patient comes with chest pain, we cannot say this could be aortic dissection right away. So first thing is you rule out that it is not acute coronary. Second thing is you rule out it is not pulmonary embolism. Third thing, and it is one of the, of all the chest syndromes, acute chest syndromes, this is the rarest, that is the acute aortic dissection. So this is the first point which I'd like to make as a practical, as a clinician. Second thing is, so you have ruled out that it is not acute coronary, this thing is normal. Your investigations are normal, ECG is normal, echo is normal, and whatever you say that it is not acute coronary, you do a D-dimer and rule out that it is not pulmonary embolism also, there is no evidence of any other clots in the body. So the next thing what you think suggest is, rightly so, you have to come down to seeing that, rule out that it is an aortic dissection. So aortic dissection, first thing, you don't do a CT scan, you do an echo. 2D echo is very important because it can be done on the bedside. It can be done by emergency clinician. We don't want any expertise. We don't want any anything. We don't want any time to be wasted. So you do an aortic, you do an aortic imaging with a 2D echo. You can also image not just the ascending aorta. You can also image the ascending, the arch of aorta. Just by putting in the suprasternal notch, you can see that arch is normal or not. Any doubt, again, we have protocol set up, so we can go ahead. So that is one part of the story. The second thing is, when we come, so we have ruled out acute, the other two possibilities, and we know that it is an acute aortic syndrome. So it is an acute aortic syndrome, could be an acute aortic syndrome. So in this also, again, there are four things which you have to consider. When you say aortic syndrome, it is because patient is ruled out of other two things. You think that it is acute aortic syndrome, and you see that echo is normal, ascending aorta is normal, and the arch of aorta is normal on imaging. You cannot say that it is not aortic dissection. So there are four things which you have to consider in an acute aortic syndrome. The most common of that is, again, aortic dissection. It can be a type A dissection and type B dissection. That we'll come back to that. The next thing is, the patient can have a ruptured aortic aneurysm. That is also commonly what we see, especially in the elderly population. There could be an unnoticed aortic aneurysm which is ruptured, and the patient has come with acute ruptured aortic aneurysm. Third thing is a penetrating aortic ulcer. This also you have to remember. Everything seems normal, but the patient is having pain. So there will be a small ulcer which has penetrated into the media. Rightly said, you say that it's a precursor for dissection, some people say. So it could be acute penetrating aortic ulcer. The second thing is an intramural hematoma. It mimics a dissection. It is a slightly less serious of a problem, but the symptoms are similar. The management is the same. So intramural hematoma. So these are the three things which you have to rule out apart from aortic dissection. So this is the first point I'd like to make. Am I clear? Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So the Dr. Nisha, especially for people, because sir will be the first line of defense. I need to make some small points about these things.
Yeah, true, sir.
Sir, second thing is, the presentation is not always chest pain. Presentation is, I think, in at least 20 to 30% of these patients will not be chest pain. The last type B aortic dissection which you operated, the patient presented with lower limb pain. He came with lower limb pain, and it looked like the first thing the ER clinician told me is it is acute limb ischemia. But when I saw the patient, limb is warm, but pulses are not there. Limb was warm. It was not a typical aortic limb, acute limb ischemia. So then we thought that there is something else going on. So chest pain or back pain may not be the only symptom, because especially diabetics and these patients will have multiple comorbidities, multiple issues. They may not see or they may not notice the dragging, the tearing pain that is classically described. Of course, most of these patients do present. That anyways, once the patient presents with the acute chest pain, you have a protocol, you know what to do. But the other presentations also, these can present with acute leg pain. They can present with acute abdominal pain. They can present with stroke. Stroke is anyways you have mentioned. The third thing is, these patients can present with acute change in voice. This is also very important. Hoarseness of voice. We have seen at least two patients, not here, when I was being trained in Chitra, we used to see a lot of hoarseness of voice. Acute change in voice. Patient doesn't know whom to go. He will not consult a vascular surgeon for change in voice. He may just go to an ENT surgeon. So these are the few things which we have to rule out. So elderly patient, a hypertensive, sudden change in voice. First thing you have to rule out is a malignancy. It could be a malignancy. Second thing is, this is also a possibility. So these are the points which we have to consider. Third thing is, what I see in our setup as of today is, patient presenting with acute stroke. What imaging we do? The imaging what we do is a neck as well. Neck also not many times. I see only the brain being imaged. I see most of the times. I know you will have attended all the emergencies. You do a brain imaging. That is not enough. You are only halfway through. And whenever I get a call for saying that the patient presenting stroke, the Doppler is showing some stenosis, and I open the images and all I see is brain. What is happening below down? We don't know. Then we repeat a scan. One of those patients could have an aortic dissection as well. So those things we need to consider. This meeting, especially I have attended when sir requests, I want to make through this point. When you see a patient presenting with paraparesis, paraplegia, monoplegia, any types of plegia, image from the chest. The chest imaging should be from the chest because the entry vessels, these source vessels, we are not seeing. We're just seeing the brain and saying that it is normal. No, there is only a small clot and we miss so many patients which can be treated, we are missing. So this point I want to drive through. So next point, what I want to make, what I'd like to say is the presentation being, it's covered almost everything. So there is nothing more for me to add. But per se, if you say dissections, when you say aortic dissection, we know that it stands for type A and type B, wherein ascending aorta is involved, ascending aorta is not involved. But if you look at the pathophysiology, if you look at the management wise, these two are two totally different entities. Aortic type A aortic dissection and type B aortic dissection are totally different entities, because the management is totally different in both of these. 90% of type B aortic dissections you can manage medically, but 100% of type A aortic dissections need to be managed surgically. So when you see on echo, there is a flap in the on echo, when you see that there is a flap in the ascending aorta, or even for that matter, if you see a flap, suspected flap in the arch of aorta, that means that you are dealing with a type A aortic dissection. Even before you ask for an imaging, you have to inform the cardiac surgeon, because it is not my domain. I am not authorized to do a ventral demono or whatever plan it is, because time is of essence. Every hour you lose with the type A aortic dissection, the mortality will increase by 10%. So if you are delaying 2%, 2 hours, we have already lost, because anyways with surgery, 30 to 40% of them will die post-operatively. So over that, we are adding another 10 to 15% of mortality. So when you see the imaging, when you see that there is a flap, even if you're wrong, that is fine. That doesn't matter. But you see that there is a suspected flap in the ascending aorta, first thing you have to do is you have to call the cardiac surgeon. Because by the time they come, we would have the imaging ready. Otherwise, we are losing time. These are the practical points which I want to drive through. So that is one point. So second thing, and I'll be talking only about more about type B dissection, because it is my domain and we as vascular surgeons treat type B aortic dissections. So when we say what the type of type B dissections, it can be depending on the presentation, it can be an acute type B aortic dissection. It can be a chronic type B dissection also. We see a lot of patients without any symptoms, they had a dissection, they are fine. They present later on with some other complications, maybe abdominal complications or an imaging or a general chest x-ray will show that there is a widened mediastinum. So this, it can be either acute, which is less than 2 weeks, chronic, it is beyond 2 weeks. So this is one point which I'd like to add on to this one. So the second thing is what I want to say, the reason, the malperfusion, the dynamic obstruction, the static obstruction, whatever, is all explained very beautifully. Dynamic is more common, static is mainly because of thrombosis, that is all fine. So next, what I'd like to focus more on is the management part the management part. The protocol what we follow is called the Wheat and Palmer regimen. That means that it is the medical, whatever, same beta blocker, same SNP, same nitroglycerin, along with giving a good analgesia. Yeah. The Wheat and Palmer, the target is to reduce the heart rate up to 60 beats per minute, to reduce the mean arterial pressure to 60 to 65 mean arterial pressure, and the patient should be pain-free. So when we have decided that the it is suspected aortic dissection, a patient you have seen, you have imaged the patient, what is next you have to do? Before, you cannot just straight away shift the patient to ICU, because in shifting also he might develop complications. So first thing is give a good amount of opiate, use morphine left, right and center. The patient should be pain free. Bring down his BP to a mean arterial pressure of 65. Put an arterial line, put a central line and put a Foley's catheter. These are the three things which it is part of Wheat and Palmer regimen. It is not a mine ad. The Wheat and Palmer regimen says all these things, put a central line, put a urinary catheter, put a mean arterial line also. It's part of that treatment. So, and bring that target. So at least stabilize the patient in the initial duration, and then only you are supposed to shift the patient to the ICU. Okay. So that is the one thing. Another 2 minutes, sir. I'll be just done. Coming to endovascular management. So all patients, all type B aortic dissections will not need a surgery or any intervention immediately. So there are certain indications only when we do, only in certain indications we do intervention in the first 6 weeks of aortic dissection, that is type B. Because there are few findings. The INSTEAD trial, what you quoted is, they're all immediately stenting, immediate aortic, what we call TVAR. TVAR is thoracic endovascular and aortic repair. That is, it's a putting just a graft, a covered stent inside the aorta and closing the entry tear. So in this thing, all patients, there are two schools of thoughts. A lot of patients use, a lot of doctors or vascular surgeons straight away to go and stent it and then leave it and come out. The problem with this mentality is the intimomedial flap that is created, it is very fragile initially. It is very fragile. When you try to manipulate it, it can tear open along. We have seen patients having a small entry tear turning into a 20 centimeter entry tear. And it is very difficult to close that. It becomes an aneurysm and it is an even bigger headache. So that is why they have divided this aortic type B aortic dissection into uncomplicated and complicated. So when it is uncomplicated, best manage with medical treatment, stabilize the patient, let that intimomedial flap heal. Once it heals, then you can close the entry tear later on, ideally at 6 weeks. So that is one part of the treatment. Second thing is complicated. Anyways, you don't have an option. You have to intervene. Complication, there are again two or three criteria wherein your pain is not coming down. You are given maximum amount of morphine and the pain is still persisting. Or your BP is not coming down. You have given the maximum dose of beta blockers, other medications you have used, but the BP is still on the higher side. Having a higher BP with an already existing aortic dissection is inviting problems because the patient can develop malperfusion. The patient can develop multiple tears. And the third most important thing is the patient a type B aortic dissection can develop a retrograde tear. Retrograde tear means the uncomplicated type B is converting into a type B aortic dissection, which needs emergency surgery again. So BP control is very important because that entry tear has gone down. There is nothing preventing the entry tear to go up back into the aortic arch and the ascending aorta. Such cases also we have seen. I've got some images also of those things. There will be no entry tear in the ascending aorta, no entry tear in the arch of aorta, but an entry tear in post-subclavian aorta, filling both down as well as retrogradely. So that means that a type B aortic dissection is complicated into an retrograde arch extension. So that is one thing. Third thing is malperfusion, any malperfusion, whether it is lower limb malperfusion or it is renal malperfusion. Usually, most commonly, it is the left renal artery that gets compressed because that is the artery which will usually originate from the false lumen. This thing, the identification of the false lumen and all is technically it's our job. Diagnosing aortic dissection and then handing it over to the people, that is technically not needed for this audience, I feel. So once we see that the left renal artery is more commonly being the artery that gets thrombosed because it is most commonly arising from the false lumen. Other arteries are usually because of dynamic obstruction, as madam said. It could be because of just compression or the flap is so flappy that it is just touching onto the ostium and then preventing the blood flow into those organs. So lower limb and abdominal, any visceral malperfusion. So these are the complications. These are the patients who need an immediate treatment. And open surgery is almost always, I feel it is almost always as the last option as of today, because the results with endovascular management, with the TVAR, with the stent, with bare metal stent, so many options are available. So the results are much better, as said by INSTA trial. Even the other trial also says that the results are better as compared to medical management. What we do is we just close the entry tear with a stent. Once we close, the flow will automatically get diverted into the true lumen. The true lumen, which is very small initially, it slowly, gradually over a period of time, it will dilate. And the false lumen usually slowly narrows and thromboses off. So that is the management. The admin, can I show some images if it is possible?
Yes, sir, you can share the screen.
You can share the screen, sir.
How? Because okay, share screen is there. Okay, share screen. Okay. Yes, sir. Sorry, I didn't see this one actually. Okay. You are able to
see? Yeah, we are able to see, sir.
Okay, so
the just thing is the what... slideshow, sir. slideshow.
Yeah, I'm doing so. So endovascular management, what I'd like to say is this is the graft which we use. This is a standard TEVAR graft. It is a thoracic endovascular aneurysm or aortic repair graft. Multiple companies are there. They suggest it is a similarly a bare metal strut covered by a polyester covering. So it's a depending on what size it is, what size we need, that measurements and all we do. We see the normal aorta and then we see, we usually oversize because it is just staying by radial force. We are not suturing or there is no hooks or there is no clips inside. So we have to slightly oversize and then put it. So some example is, for example, in this patient, we see that there is a classical aortic dissection. We see that one part is large, the second part is small, but the smaller is very bright when the larger one is slightly grayish. So this shows that the larger one is the false lumen and the smaller one is the true lumen. And as we see, we can see that there is an intimal tear at the, it's an atypical aortic dissection. It's not a standard or it's not a typical Stanford type B dissection. This we operated three, four years back, I think. So what we did, what happened is there is a small entry tear in the distal distal part of the descending thoracic aorta, which is causing more of abdominal dissection and very less of thoracic aortic dissection. So there is narrowing. There was some amount of malperfusion. So what we have done is we have covered it with a stent graft. So once you put a stent graft, the flow obviously gets diverted into the true lumen. So open surgical, we have done few cases, not here in the previous this thing, wherein we replace that segment and then use a small cuff of polyester graft and then we suture it off and then we can direct the flow into the true lumen. So coming to when the patient presents with malperfusion, there's some examples which we have done. These are all our own cases. Malperfusion, what we have seen is one patient developing options are surgical fenestration. Anyways, we have not done. It's a very cumbersome procedure. Patients will usually have multiple problems and they don't survive. There is this option for hybrid approach for a malperfusion. For example, this patient had a celiac artery malperfusion and because of an aortic dissection. So what we have done is we have done a hybrid procedure. That means we have opened the abdomen. We have diverted blood flow to the celiac from the from a iliac vessel. So we have taken an inflow from the iliac, given a graft to the celiac, and then ligated the celiac proximally because there is this dissection at that base. And then what we have done is we have just put a stent graft into that so that the morbidity of malperfusion is reduced and we don't have to go and repair the aorta because if you notice, there is another entry point in the post-subclavian aorta. So these are all atypical patients. They do present, especially in high volume centers. We see once in a while only, but such patients are possible. They could be, these are all atypical type B aortic dissections. Ascending and arch is normal. There is an entry tear here. Mid, it is normal. And then in the abdominal aorta or the distal part of the descending thoracic aorta, there is another entry tear. With celiac getting compressed, patient developing abdominal pain. Such patients can be treated with hybrid procedures, and then these patients will usually do well. So coming to finally, what I'd like to say is it is a complicated decision. It is a difficult diagnosis, but when we follow meticulously and use protocol based on our hospital or any protocols, we can fair amount of cases we can detect. And most of the cases which need to be treated can be treated. And again, same INSTA trial is there that says that best medical management with an endovascular graft will be better than just best medical management. So that is what I'd like to add on to the whatever madam has said. Anyways, a good presentation. Sir, over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Prakash, sir. Really, this is called expertise. Thank you, sir. Thanks for your insight and thanks for input. Now I'd like to welcome Dr. Suresh MVN, who is heading the department of the hospital, Somajigoda. So he is one of the moderators for this session. I welcome you, Dr. Suresh. Suresh, do you want to add any more points over here?
I think nothing more. It's over. It's over 50 minutes. Initially, it was started by, I think, well, presentation. It was very well done, Dr. Misha. And end points by Prakash Gore, sir, they're exemplary. I think nothing more to add. I think any doubts, I mean, related to the participants, I think we can clear it off.
Some question, Q&A I can see here.
Yeah. Sir, can I take a few questions?
Yes, sir.
I think first question to Dr. Misha. So what are the differential diagnosis when you are dealing suspected case of aortic dissection?
The first and foremost differential diagnosis is acute coronary syndrome. Then we can suspect acute pericarditis and pulmonary conditions like pulmonary embolism, pleurisy. Then any intra-abdominal conditions, then stroke, this all can be the differential diagnosis.
Yeah, as we said, so it is tricky to diagnose in emergency department itself. So then, second question. So role of beta blockers in aortic dissection. This is for you, Dr. Misha, again.
Okay, beta blockers are the cornerstone of management. Because they can control the heart rate as well as the BP. So as I mentioned, labetalol and esmolol are the primary choices. And then we can, in patients with COPD or asthma who cannot tolerate beta, in those patients, we can add cardioselective beta blockers like metoprolol or atenolol. So they can decrease both the BP and heart rate.
Heart rate, true. Then one more question. So any clues in the history to know whether it is Stanford A or Stanford B classification? Dr. Suresh, can you take up this question?
Yes, sir, truly. I think, as we said, aortic dissection mainly classified into Stanford type A and type B. As we all know, type A will be managed by surgically and they compromise 60% of the aortic dissection. I think type B. Coming to the question, I think asked about the relevant clinical features and common symptoms. Type A generally presented with chest pain. And I think type B is abdo pain. Predominantly, but not every time, but they might be presented with relevant symptoms, but these are all the commonest symptoms which occur with the Stanford type A and type B. And sometimes type B, I think they present with syncope also, yes. Yeah,
exactly, sir. Then one more question. What are the physical examination findings when you are suspecting case of aortic dissection? So with your permission, can I take this question?
Yes, sir.
Operation? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So as we discussed earlier, so there are wide variety of symptoms. Then when we come to the physical examination, so we can see wide variety of signs as well. So when it comes to physical examination, so sometimes we can see aortic insufficiency murmur. It can be seen about 30 to 35% of the people. Then pulse deficits, sometimes and difference BP in both arms more than 20 mmHg. Then some patients may present with hypertension. Some people may with the hypotension. Then sometimes, as Dr. Prakash Gaurasar said, pressure effects on recurrent laryngeal nerve and sympathetic ganglions, like hoarseness of voice, Horner syndrome, and dysphagia. So these are the few findings. Then other than these things, sometimes these cases present with history of stroke, then paraplegia. Then sometimes SOB is due to pericardial effusion. If it is dissecting the root of the aorta, it leads to pericardial effusion. That itself causes hypotension, SOB, all these things. So these are the few points, few physical examination findings, which gives clues towards the diagnosis of aortic dissection. Prakash sir, do you want to add any more points here?
No, sir. All points are well taken, sir. Very nicely explained. I think that should sum up. It is more of diagnosis by ruling out than by directly saying that it is aortic dissection.
Yes, sir. Few more questions here. Sir, I think you are the right person to take this question, Dr. Prakash sir.
Sir.
So, just hold on, sir.
Common areas to get it.
No, sir. So, that is a very simple question. So, we need your expertise. Then we need to get some knowledge from you as well. So, when to refer to a vascular surgeon? So, when you are referring a case to a vascular surgeon, what to communicate to you? Yes.
So, type A, please don't call me, sir. Because it is not my domain. Type B, what we can do is there is a CT protocol called triple rollout protocol. So you are not sure it is acute coronary or it is pulmonary embolism or it is aortic dissection. You can ask for a CT triple rollout protocol. That means that in a single imaging, they can see the coronary arteries, they can see the pulmonary vessels, as well as the aorta. That is a ECG gated imaging. They do it very quickly. It takes hardly 2 to 3 minutes. It will not take much of a time. Only thing is, you have to add, just before shifting, you have to give one dose of beta blocker. So reduce the heart rate. So once you've done that imaging, you are very clear, you know whom to refer. And all type B dissections should be referred to a vascular surgeon. Whether it is managed medically or it is managed surgically, they have to be managed this thing. Second thing is, especially when the patient is presenting with lower limb pain or any end organ damage, when you see that there is an end organ ischemia, then more so, because that those are the patients who need an immediate intervention. Even if the patient is uncomplicated, if you don't call also, if you are able to manage, that is well and good. But any end organ damage, you have to inform. Second thing is, a patient, as madam said, patient presenting with hypertension, and you see that there is pseudo hypertension also. So once there is a pseudo things, there's a lot of confusion, because you don't know whether the false lumen ruptured into the chest cavity. There could be a small leak. It may not rupture and burst open and everything will come out. There will be a small leak. So patient will have episodes of hypertension because he's slowly bleeding into the cavity. So those things also, you have to be very careful. Any suspicion of aortic dissection and patient having hypertension is very, because so many possibilities you have to rule out. And as for that, nothing else is there. All aortic dissections has to come to me. There is nothing will not come to me, but it's well and good. Then we will decide on further management. We can take care, we can manage initially with beta blockers, and then later on we can call for TPA.
Thank you, sir.
And you people are doing a commendable job, sir. You should appreciate, because by the time we are gone, we go and see the patient, already everything is made. We just have to make a decision on what to do. So
thank you, sir.
That is so really nice.
It happened all because of your guidance, sir.
I am one of them.
Guidance from seniors like you and all. So then, one more question for you, sir. As yes, I asked previously, common areas to get there.
Common areas, most common are type in aortic dissections. I'd say 60% to 70% are type A dissections. In that, again, 20% will be type B dissections, and another 10% will be like atypical dissections, what I have showed. So most common is still again type A. Then 20% type B and 10% is atypical dissections. In type B, most common site is the 1 centimeter surrounding the base of the subclavian artery, that is left subclavian artery, because that is the area where lot of hemodynamic factors are acting. Because when you see the blood flow, when you image the blood flow, the pressure changes across any two part of the aorta or any vessel for that matter is the maximum at that point. That is called the aortic knuckle area. So that is where that pressure changes are so great that is the most common area for type B aortic dissection to develop.
Thank you, sir. So really, it was wonderful discussion. So I thank you, Dr. Nisha, Dr. Prakash Gora, sir, and Dr. Amin Suresh. So with this, we can conclude our webinar session for today. So thank you, Arundal.
Thank you.